Welcome to Commonwealth Politics. I'm George Serra.
And I'm Mark Kemper.
Our topic today is the 2016 presidential race and lower ballots. And today we have with us State Representative Jay Livingstone and State Representative Keiko Orrall.
Thank you for both of you for coming. I'd like to start off with a broad question, thinking about the result of the national election. And let's start with you, Representative Livingstone, because the Democrats, from hearing from the Republican side, took a major shellacking at the national level in this election. Could you talk a little bit about what you think, how you think the Democratic Party should respond, and what some of the implications might be with respect to the results of the election in terms of the national political process?
Well, I disagree that the Democrats took a shellacking. It was certainly a disappointing night for Democrats. Hillary Clinton lost to Donald Trump, but Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by more than 2 million votes, which no nominee has ever lost has won that by that much. Donald Trump's victory was by the narrowest of margins in a handful of states because of our electoral college system. In the Senate, while the Democrats didn't gain control of the Senate, the Democrats picked up, I think, 4 seats in the Senate to close that gap. There's still a seat that's open in Louisiana where there could be another Democrat winning. In the House, the gap was closed, where Republicans lost a number of seats. Paul Ryan is still going to be the Speaker. But overall, while it was disappointing the Democrats couldn't flip some of these bodies and maintain the presidency, Democrats made up grounds in every part of the country. And in the next time, I think for the presidential election 4 years from now, it's win these close races. There were a handful of states that were lost by less than 1%. And in an election that close, any little thing can happen. And a better campaign or whatnot could have done a better job. And so it's just not run a better campaign next time, I guess.
So let me just follow up with
that. That is a beautiful sentiment, and that is a very hopeful sentiment.
So just to follow up with that, do you dispute the fact,
I mean,
do you think that the Republicans, that President-elect Trump has a mandate here to push through a significant agenda that they have?
The Republicans did very well on election night, and so we now control not only the executive branch, but we control the House as well as the Senate, as well as 68 out of 99 chambers across the country. I think what we see from the election night map, you'll see that the middle of the country is predominantly red. And I feel like the next election cycle, we're going to see even more of those seats turning that maybe are blue right now. They're going to be turning red because what his message was, it was a message of change, and it was a message to the working class. It was a message to people who feel like they have been forgotten by the system, who feel like government isn't working, and that they want something different in Washington, D.C. Whether or not our candidate can deliver that, whether or not Donald Trump is going to be able to be successful with that, I don't know if it's a mandate, but that's the direction that people want to see him head. And I think that you'll see that on the progressive side of the Democrat Party as well with the Sanders folks. The Sanders folks want to see change in Washington, D.C. They feel like there's a bit of a rigged system, and they want to see that change.
Well, the reality is that the number of seats that the Democrats hold in Congress is as low as it's been since the late 1920s. So it wasn't a good day for the Democratic Party. Having said that, what do you think the party needs to do now to reach out to those blue-collar worker voters who, by all accounts, feel left behind by the Democratic Party?
Well, again, this stuff changes in a heartbeat. Mm-hmm. In 2006, in 2004, the Republicans had almost as many seats as they have now. In 2006, they became a Democratic majority. In 2012, I was celebrating because Democrats won control of the Senate. They won Obama won re-election. And now, 4 years later, all of a sudden, people are talking about a Republican mandate in the country. And for the mandate, I don't know what it would be. Donald Trump, the day after the election, I heard Speaker Ryan say that the first thing they need to do is change the way we have Medicare. And in the exact opposite way that Donald Trump campaigned on not changing that program.
Right, but what do the Democrats need to do? That's what we're focusing on right now. What do the Democrats need to do?
The Democrats, you know, there were certain positions, particularly regarding trade, that Hillary Clinton took that I think were out of line with where voters are, which were more in line with Bernie Sanders. And I think you've seen within the Democratic Party at a lot of lower levels being more suspicious of trade deals and making sure that industries in the United States aren't left behind. For so many trade deals, there's a long-term benefit for the United States, but there'll be a certain industry that will be killed right away as jobs move to wherever we're sending the deal with. And Hillary Clinton and the Clintons in the 90s were really free traders. Bernie Sanders really made that a key issue in this race, and I think going forward, you're going to see the Democratic Party much more responsive to those industries, which were traditionally represented by best by Democrats. And I think what you're going to see going forward is, I don't know what Donald Trump stands for. You know, he said, I'm angry and I'm going to clean up Washington. How he's going to do that, I have no idea. He's filling his cabinet with lobbyists, which is inconsistent with what you'd expect from somebody saying that. But his agenda, whatever it is vastly different than the Republicans that are in control of Congress. And I think the Medicare example is the first one. And I think as you go forward, there's a lot of people that voted for Trump, a lot of people that voted for Republican. They're going to realize that their agenda is not for working families. I read yesterday that Donald Trump believes that the minimum wage, which is an issue he's talked about, he's been in favor of raising the minimum wage, he's been in favor of lowering the minimum wage, he's been all over the place. The Republicans in Congress have consistently wanted to lower the minimum wage, that all of a sudden wages are too high and that's something he's going to attack. That's going right at working families. That's a Democratic issue. 2 years ago in the House of Representatives of Massachusetts, we raised the minimum wage to one of the highest in the country. The Republicans in Massachusetts didn't support that move. And that's one of many examples that as you dive into the issues, working families are better represented by Democrats than they are by Republican interests.
Right, but to the point of what can the Democratic Party do, and what the Republican Party did this time around was they went into those communities, they went into the working families, talking to the blue-collar workers about what it's really like to be at a factory that has closed up and moved and gone off to another country. And so those are the types of people that we're trying to listen to. But we're also listening to the business owners and the effects, the unintended and consequences of raising the minimum wage and the effect that it has on a step type of pay system, where you're going to have to not just raise the minimum wage, you have to raise the guy above the minimum wage, and then it's a ripple effect as far as wages, and that has an impact on the larger business and I think expansion of business. So those are the conversations that I think people are hoping that President-elect Trump will have with businesses and to find out what can we do to help you grow your business so that we can provide more opportunities for people in the working class.
One of the things that we heard a lot on from especially candidate Trump was the repealing of Obamacare. Right? He's maybe backtracked a little bit on that.
Right.
But hypothetically, if Obamacare were to be repealed and not replaced with anything, where does that leave the state? Because we had Romney Care, which was a very similar program at the state level, where individuals had there was a mandate to have insurance, health insurance. Would we just fall back to the old Romney Care system in the state if Obamacare were to be repealed
and
not replaced?
People much smarter than I in the administration and in the legislature looking at this issue. Our healthcare system is completely intertwined with the federal system. And so it's not, from what I understand, it's not that easy to disconnect the two. And it depends on our system depends on a lot of federal funding. Governor Baker was bragging just a couple weeks ago about signing a Medicare waiver for the
right.
next 5 years. That's subject to Obamacare being in place. Mm-hmm. The agreement which the federal government insisted upon includes a clause that says it's subject to federal law, and which is in every federal contract. And so those type of there will be drastic consequences.
I think all of those things will be taken into consideration as far as moving forward with any type of repealing or replacing of Obamacare. The effect on our states, it's not like people are going to be left high and dry. And here in Massachusetts, we did have and do have a good health care system. So I believe that all of those types of things will be taken into careful account. And as far as this administration, I believe he's going to surround himself with folks who are very knowledgeable about the system.
But the Medicaid expansion right under Obamacare, which included a vast increase in the number of people covered under Medicaid, that for the first several years was paid entirely by the federal government. If that were to be repealed, I mean, that would have drastic consequences on the poor in Massachusetts receiving health care. Right. So we're just not sure what's going to happen in terms of the
Right, but what I'm saying is that as part of that repeal, people who are making those decisions are aware of the effect that it's going to have on the poor and are not going to be folks who are just leaving people high and dry. That's where I think the media has driven the sound bites that Republicans aren't compassionate. We are compassionate. We absolutely care about the poor. We're trying to get to a better solution so that we have our taxpayer dollars using the best, doing the best that we can.
The Republicans in Congress have passed a bill that just wipes out Obamacare 60-something times. They knew that that had absolutely no chance of ever becoming law. Now that whatever they pass could actually become law, they have a president that could potentially sign something. It'll be interesting to see what they came up with. But going back to the situation we were in before Obamacare was passed, there were millions of people in the United States that were uninsured, that there was a huge cost on our healthcare system where people wouldn't get primary care help. They'd show up in an emergency room and it would be much more costly. And Obamacare changed a lot of that. There are millions and millions of people in the United States today, hundreds of thousands in Massachusetts that are covered that wouldn't have been otherwise covered.
But it's still, still unpopular by a majority of the public since it was passed. And in part, what we've seen are premium raises. In fact, that was a big issue in this campaign,
right,
that premiums have gone up 100%, for example, in Arizona. So the costs may be under control for some, but not for the vast majority of the American public.
You've had a situation where there was a law changed.
And I'm not for or against, these are just facts.
That a law changed that couldn't be modified. The situation in Congress was either repeal it entirely or it has to remain in place. And many have suggested that the Republicans in Congress wanted it to fail, wanted to have some of these anomalies that have happened throughout the system be present. You know, premium rates have increased in the country. Generally, for the United States, premiums have increased at a significantly slower rate than they were increasing prior to Obamacare. So you have to be careful when you're saying healthcare costs have increased. Healthcare costs have been skyrocketing for 20 years, and not since Obamacare. Obamacare has actually slowed down those costs. So if you just repeal Obamacare, you have to wonder what's really going to happen with premiums, because a lot of the cost controls that have been put in place will be gone. And so I hope the Republicans in Congress are more thoughtful than their discussions to date about repealing Obamacare have been. Because I'm personally worried that millions of people that couldn't have gotten insurance before are going to not have insurance again. That ratepayers across the country, including Massachusetts, are going to have significantly higher premiums and have premiums increasing at a significantly higher rate than currently. And those situations will be made worse if it's just a repeal, as Republicans in Congress have talked about.
Right, but again, it's the discussion that needs to take place and the thoughtful discussion from our legislators in Congress who are hopefully making those cases and talking about the consequences of these types of decisions. What I think people are hoping for, the vast majority across America, is that something will get done in Congress, because people are so frustrated with the logjam and the just feeling like nothing is really moving forward to help the public. Well, and so that's where I feel like people are going to see some movement.
Just to shift gears, one of the other issues was immigration. I mean, that was another big campaign issue. there's been some backpedaling or soft pedaling a little bit on that as well from President-elect Trump. But if President-elect Trump does go after in a serious way the folks that are here and undocumented and here illegally, what is your position in terms of the state government's response and state agencies and cities and towns in terms of cooperating with the federal government and assisting identifying folks that are here in an undocumented fashion? Do you think, I mean, we've read about a number of cities that serve as sort of internet safe, or internet,
sanctuary cities,
and some university presidents that have said, we're not going to cooperate, we're going to protect students that might be undocumented. Do you think, what's your position in terms of state government and an institution, say, like Bridgewater State with respect to that issue? Either one of you could take that on.
I'm incredibly troubled by the comments of Donald Trump regarding immigration. You know, our country was founded by immigrants. My grandparents came here and were able to start a life, and we've been successful in this family, in this country. And everybody in the country had a parent, grandparent,
right, but for the sake of our viewers, I want to make sure that you understand we're not talking about legal immigration. We're talking about illegal immigration, and there is a difference between the two. And what the president-elect is talking about is illegal immigration.
Actually, he's not. He's talking about a registry for every Muslim, whether they're coming here legally or not.
I think we have to stop with that, because I think that's a media soundbite. I don't know that that has been put out as far as a plan that is something that he wants to implement. Was that said? Perhaps, but there's where
he said it hundreds of times on the campaign, thousands of times on the campaign.
As far as creating a Muslim,
and one of his advisors, several days after the election, made the announcement we're going to do it, and that I'm working on it. I mean that.
When we're talking about illegal immigrants, we're talking about folks who have not followed the correct path to get to our country. And so we have cities here in the Commonwealth who are protecting those types of people. And the question is whether or not the federal government has is going to be funding those sanctuary cities. And what I feel like we need to have people who are following the laws. We should also be working with the federal government to help them with understanding the criminal element within the illegal immigrant population.
But I think if ICE finds somebody who's here illegally, they should deport them. I don't think.
But within
state
a sanctuary
local,
city, they don't.
I don't think state and local authorities should have anything to do with it. Under our constitutional system, state and local authorities have nothing to do with immigration. Moreover, I used to be a prosecutor in Middlesex County, and I saw how this played out. So often, there would be somebody who was arrested, there would be an ICE detainer issued, the person would be held for that reason, they would be released a few days later because ICE never came and picked them up. It was a complete waste. Moreover, it makes the situation more dangerous because people were afraid to report crimes to local authorities if they're fearful of being deported. And as a prosecutor, I heard many times people say, this person doesn't want to come, this victim of a serious violent crime doesn't want to come forward because they're afraid immigration authorities are going to come pick them up if they come to the courthouse. And that's not a situation we want to be encouraging. The federal government has a role with respect to immigration. Under our constitutional system, the state is precluded from participating in that role. And if it does participate in that role, it's only going to encourage people to prey upon people who may not have proper documentation to be here.
But again, what resonated with people across America, across middle America, is that we want our resources to go to our vets. We want our resources to go to our elderly. And we are not okay with people who are here without legal status. We want people to come legally. We're not racist. We're not people who are against other countries. We're not xenophobes. We are trying to say, please come here legally. And that's where I think that people are very concerned about illegal immigration, and that's where his message, he started off with that back a year ago. I think it gathered steam as it went on because of crimes like Kate Steinle and because of criminal actions from people who are not here with legal status.
I guess the most interesting thing to me about this discussion is that by all measures, illegal immigration in the United States is at an all-time or a low for the last 50 years, that there are fewer people coming to the United States illegally now than at any point, and that the numbers are half what they were even 10 years ago.
Where are those stats coming from?
ICE. And the...
Right, but so then what do we do with the people who are here without legal status who are committing crimes? They don't have a right to be here legally. So then how do we justify that type of behavior? We can't.
Well, even Obama has gone after those that are committing crimes for deporting. I guess what we're... And Trump has said that he's largely going to continue with that process,
right,
going after those that are committing,
right,
criminal activity.
But, right.
But what do you do with those that aren't doing that but are undocumented and are technically illegal?
So I think what he has said is that we're going after the criminals first. We're going to do something about the wall and the fence and the border. And I think in some ways that's a literal and a figurative wall, meaning that we're going to take steps to make sure we know who's coming in and
right
out of our country. And that's where we're going to start the conversation of, well, what do we do with those folks who are here who aren't committing crimes, but who are here, they either overstayed a visa or they were brought here as a child.
So one of the other things that seems to have real consequences or potential real consequences at the state level is this massive infrastructure program that we're hearing being talked about, that both Clinton and Trump proposed, $1 trillion of infrastructure spending. One question, though, is given that Massachusetts overwhelmingly supported Clinton, is that likely to be something that we're not going to get a lot of that money? Do you think that we're going to be punished as a result of that? And if not, do we have projects ready to go? That we could tap into some of that money to, you know, the MBTA comes to mind, and other things, projects that the legislature has been wanting to go with, but we just don't have the money, that we're ready to go with for federal money.
There are always plenty of infrastructure projects to do. We were talking right before this about South Coast Rail, which is right in this area, has been something that people think is long overdue, which depends on a lot of federal money. There are a lot of connections in the state that need to be made, and there are a lot of upgrades to the current system that could be made. You know, I certainly hope the Republicans don't retaliate against Massachusetts in the way that you suggest, and that Donald Trump isn't vindictive in that way. But it's what's more interesting to me is whether or not, you know, the day after the election, Democratic House leadership said, we want to take you up on this offer, President-elect Trump. We want to do $1 billion infrastructure program for the United States. And it'll be interesting to see how...
A trillion.
How the Tea Party Republicans in the House of Representatives in the U.S. Congress react to that, because they were strongly opposed to any type spending like this in the past. And so it'd be interesting to see how the Democrats actually line up with President Trump on that issue and how the Republicans react to that.
I don't think President-elect Trump is going to be vindictive towards Massachusetts. I feel like he's already made steps to show that he wants to include people from Massachusetts, and that he's interviewed Senator Scott Brown for the Secretary
from
of Veterans
Hampshire.
Affairs. Oh, he did move to New Hampshire, but he was a former senator from Massachusetts. And that he's entertaining conversations with the former governor, Mitt Romney. And so that to me says, no, Massachusetts is very much a player on the national scene, and someone like President-elect Trump understands the importance of our state in the overall economy. So I don't feel like that's a real threat. I believe that our delegation needs to understand that they should want to work with the administration, and I feel like if they're advocating for our state, we are going to see those infrastructure monies come back to
Let's
our state.
Go back to where we started when we were talking about the election results outcome. Clearly, the Democratic Party in the House and Senate numbers are down to historic levels. You have now 34 governors are Republican. Republicans won significant state House seats, maybe not in Massachusetts, but throughout the country. And I guess my question to both of you is, has the Democratic Party moved a little bit too far to the progressive side for middle America? Because clearly, the coasts like what they saw, but the rest of the country didn't. So how do you, as a Democrat, see the party responding to that? Because it is a political reality, And then your thoughts on that.
I think that there are always discussions within political parties on the best path forward.
Because even Minority Leader Pelosi is being challenged
by somebody from the Midwest making that exact pitch.
Right.
And one of our members of our delegation have supported that. It would be, you always have to make sure that you're being representative of the entire country. What was interesting about this presidential race to me was how, and especially the election of Donald Trump, is how Donald Trump on some issues is incredibly conservative, on other issues is far to the left. Mm-hmm. And so the mandate that was that right, you spoke about earlier was not for what I would say are the core Republican beliefs, which were largely rejected by Donald Trump and rejected even by Republican voters in the primary. I think the voters, I heard the best analogy I heard for this election.
You mean not here?
was that this was like the voters just being so pissed off and just taking a rock and throwing it through the window. And that's how they were going to get back at it. And I don't think there was as much thought to particular issues. And especially Donald Trump on any given issue took five different positions and didn't seem to cost him.
But does the Democratic Party need to kind of reevaluate itself in line of Rep. Ryan from Ohio, who's arguing that the party has abandoned the working class voters?
Well, I think what I said earlier was, particularly with respect to trade and refocusing on some of the traditional Democratic voters, union factory workers, rural farmers, there are some issues that Democrats nationally need to focus on, that even in the state we need to focus on to some degree. We don't have a lot of farmers in Massachusetts.
We do have farmers. I'm going to the Farm Bureau annual meeting on Thursday in Peabody.
Not as many.
Shout out to the farmers.
And it's, but for a particular issue, I think trade is probably the biggest issue. And I think you're going to see that as a nationally as a different issue for Democrats. Generally, I don't think this was a rejection of Democratic principles or Republican principles. I think it was just a really unique
aberration.
I think it's a rejection of Democratic principles, and I think that, that it is because the Democrat Party has moved too far left. And so that's where, when I'm talking with folks in my district who are Democrat, they're talking about some of the policies of the Democratic Party, and they feel like they've been left behind, that they're not being heard on illegal immigration, they're not being heard on the costs associated with the Affordable Care Act. And that's where they want government to work, and they don't feel like the Democrat Party is listening to them. So that's where Donald Trump, he comes along and he says, listen, try me, I'm going to go get it done. And that's, I think, why they were...
And that has to be the last word, I'm sorry. Thank you both for being with us. We're out of time. Thank you for watching Commonwealth Politics.
See you next time.